introduce Dr. Chris Thomson. You know, for those of you that weren't here on Tuesday or in October, Chris is the a new surgeon at a hospital in a referral hospital in San Diego after just finishing his surgical oncology fellowship. And that was after he's finished his residency at the University of Minnesota. He is the website chair, technological chair for the VES. And, you know, all thanks should go to Chris for, you know, spurring this, you know, members in training webinar series. And actually for all the webinars, to be honest, these were all Chris's idea. So we, you know, appreciate all that he's done. And, you know, we'll look forward to his presentation here.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Can you hear me fine? Okay. So I am going to talk mostly about minimally invasive options for cystoliths with a focus on laparoscopic procedures. And I love this quote from the ACVIM consensus statement from Lulich et al. In an age of advancing endoscopic and lithotripsy technology, the management of urolithiasis poses a unique opportunity to advance compassionate veterinary care. I thought the entire consensus statement was phenomenal, and just in how they really lay out some of the recommendations that we should consider for patients with urinary stones. And it's one of those situations where getting this started in facilities that have not previously done minimally invasive approaches to bladder stones in particular can be a massive struggle. And there's definitely a reason for that, meaning that there are surgeons that are very comfortable and very good at performing cystotomies in the exact same way that they've done it for the last 10, 15 years. But I do think that there are advantages of doing some of these minimally invasive procedures that are hard to make a objective proof from, just on the basis of yes, it's possible to do a mini laparotomy and do a cystotomy through a 3, 4, or 5 centimeter incision. But truly the advantages that you get from the laparoscopy endoscopy come from the visualization, as well as the less trauma, I guess, for those patients. And so absolutely, I think that is something that should be improved and increased in its capacity throughout some of our clinics. But I do think it's going to take some time. So we'll be mostly focusing on, this is one of my patients, Haiku, from previously, focusing on these urinary bladder and urethral stones. We'll talk about Haiku a couple different times throughout the presentation. And one thing just to say up front is that it seems like there are, there's a new phrase or a new wording on how to describe a minimally invasive approach to bladder stones every week. Every publication seems to decide to rename the procedure based off of a slight modification. And I will mostly focus on what I would consider the two main laparoscopic options or cystoscopic options. I'll mostly stick with the phrase percutaneous cystolithotomy, as I think that's where a lot of the more recent literature has stuck with in terms of a title. But you'll find other things like cystoscopic assisted cystotomy, laparoscopic assisted cystotomy. There are other options that can be considered for various patients, meaning that cystoscopic lithotripsy is a great option if you have small single stones, or even voiding neural hydropulsion for some of the female dogs with very small stones. But again, mostly for the purposes of this talk, I'll focus on the PCCL, or percutaneous cystolithotomy, and a lap-assisted cystotomy. So there's actually been a fair amount of data for these procedures over the last several years. Just starting with some basics from just cystotomies. The general concern for cystotomies is that the bladder is incredibly sensitive to any kind of surgical trauma, as well as the trauma from the stones themselves. And just wanted to bring this out there, kind of throw this paper out there, and that They did find roughly a 40 to 50% incidence of minor complications of dysuria, hematuria, and polyuria following a conventional or open cystotomy. And I don't necessarily know if this is consistent with most hospitals, but they had a mean duration of hospitalization of 4.1 days. Again, I think a lot of that has to do with just the academic teaching hospital, and there were some cases that skewed those results, but a cystotomy is not a benign procedure by any means. And the other thing that, especially doing vet school and residency at University of Minnesota, we were very much told and reminded many times from Dr. Lulich that suture is absolutely associated with recurrent urolifts, meaning that if you look back at all of the stones from University of Minnesota, roughly 10% of them have been able to identify a suture nidus within those recurrent stones specifically, 4% for cats. And again, particularly for calcium oxalate stones, there's a much higher odds ratio for having that suture channel or the suture related nidus for those stones. And so while the laparoscopic or cystoscopic assisted cystotomy doesn't eliminate the need for suture within the urinary bladder, I think that if we can minimize that, there is hopefully and will hopefully eventually be data that suggests that we have less recurrence for those patients. Again, coming from Dr. Lulich, looking at laser lithotripsy, again, we for a long time now have been trying to minimize the trauma, minimize the effect on the sensitive organ of the urinary bladder. And so Dr. Lulich is incredibly good at these laser lithotripsies, did have a study comparing the lithotripsy to cystotomy, found that the duration of hospitalization was obviously shorter for the lithotripsy group, meaning that they almost always go home the same day. The procedure time is shorter for a conventional surgery. I don't think that there's a surprise there. But they didn't find any difference with the urolith removal rate, the procedure cost, the anesthesia time, or any of the evaluated complications. First, kind of getting to the actual advent of using cystoscopy from a percutaneous or a surgical standpoint, as well as laparoscopy, was from the group that was all at Penn at the time, but Dr. Runge, Chicken Allison, Brent Chickwise, and Phil Mayhew, kind of started the trend for performing laparoscopic assisted cystotomies. And I think one of the really great things from their paper that they made note of is that you really do have a ability to perform this and do these procedures on a wide variety of urinary stones, meaning that it doesn't have to be just small stones. It doesn't have to be just single stones, meaning that if you do have the dog that has numerous stones within the urinary bladder, it's still an option to consider the laparoscopic assisted procedure. They had a very short procedure time, and there's some tricks that we'll talk about to kind of maximize your efficiency for these procedures. And the big thing for these patients is that all were discharged within 24 hours, meaning that it's something that you're really minimizing the effect on the patient, both from a pain standpoint, as well as from the trauma to the urinary bladder. Kind of moving on to additional evaluation from Florida, they looked at, again, the difference between the cost and the time required, because I think anytime that you're trying to introduce this to a hospital or to an environment, you're gonna get the pushback that it's too expensive, takes too much time. And so they found that comparing their group, they did find that surgery costs and total costs were higher for the laparoscopic assisted group. But the big thing where you get the advantage is that, especially in places with expensive hospitalization costs, you can really decrease that from doing these minimally invasive procedures. So the days in hospital, hospitalization costs can be decreased to offset those additional costs related to the more minimally invasive procedure. So they didn't find any significant difference in incomplete cystolith removal. And they did find that the pain control of the patients was easier for those that underwent a lap-assisted cystotomy. Again, from Dr. Singh, actually, and his group at OVC, looking at the comparison between the lap-assisted versus a conventional group. They did find that roughly 10% of the dogs required an open conversion. I think that A lot of this just has to do with kind of the early phase of starting any procedure. I don't know necessarily if they re-looked at their cases, if it would be as high as 10% at this point. But benefit of the lap-assisted, there's no difference in incomplete removal, meaning that you have just as good of a chance to completely eliminate the stones. Duration of surgery was not different, meaning that this is something that once you start to get good at these cases, you can still do a 60 to 80 minute lap-assisted cystotomy. And again, the big benefit that especially you don't have to convince this group, you're here because you enjoy laparoscopic surgery, but the postoperative hospitalization is significantly shorter. The pain for these patients is significantly less. But again, the surgical and the procedural costs are higher for these patients. Last paper that's been out more recently, looking at percutaneous cystolithotomy, and it's kind of the version of the procedure that at least I'll mostly discuss, is that's kind of what I was taught and what I've adopted. But truly looking at percutaneous cystolithotomy, so very small, 1 centimeter to 1.5 centimeter incision. They had a total of 59 dogs and 9 cats, and was able to do all of these procedures in roughly an hour and a half. Again, the biggest benefit for these cases is that you can get these patients out the door very quickly, meaning within 24 hours, 80% are leaving the hospital. And only 24 had lower urinary tract signs postoperatively. And I think that's a big thing to compare. Obviously, we can't compare them directly, but conventionally from the first paper we discussed, there's a 40 to 50% incidence of lower urinary tract signs versus this procedure in which you're inducing less trauma, inducing less damage to the urinary bladder. Only 24% actually had lower urinary tract signs after surgery. So again, getting back to Haiku, this was a patient that we had planned on potentially doing an open cystotomy, but discussed the option of doing a cystoscopic assisted or percutaneous cystolithotomy, mostly based off of the fact that he did have such a significant burden of urethral stones. So classic for any patient, we prepared him for surgery, we passed a urinary catheter, tried flushing everything back into the urinary bladder. In the classic situation, you flush, and there's always a frustrating stuck stone within the urethra. I think that most stones, if given enough time, you can get them to move into the urinary bladder. But again, you have to ask at what cost, meaning how much damage are we doing with these aggressive catheterizations to truly try and get the stones completely back up into the urethra? How many times do you have to sit in radiology trying to flush and really get everything back to an area where you don't have to consider something like a urethrostomy? And again, I think with these, with the advent of some of these techniques, the need for a scrotal urethrostomy for dogs is really going to be minimized, just because there's almost no area of the urinary system that you can't access with an endoscope. So general equipment needs for a PCCL. I do think that this is a little bit more equipment heavy than a lot of our other procedures. I think that this is definitely something that it does take time to accumulate a lot of these instruments if you just have a basic setup to start. But again, once you get efficient at these, this is something that it really becomes a situation where there's no need to do a conventional cystotomy when you have the ability to do this. So the general equipment would be a 5 millimeter by 10 centimeter Turnamian cannula. They do also make the shorter 5 millimeter Turnamian endo tips. Generally a 30 degree rigid telescope or a 30 degree rigid cystoscope. Definitely think that if you have the capabilities of using a cystoscope, that it's going to really improve your ability to flush and to pass your baskets. And so working with the medicine team, I think that this is something that really benefits from teamwork, meaning that if you can bring in a confident or competent internal medicine team to help with these cases, it really expedites the case itself. And then definitely recommend that you have a flexible ureteroscope available. I think that for most large females, you can get a 30-degree rigid cystoscope completely out of the urethra from the percutaneous approach, but I wouldn't bank on that for all cases. And especially for smaller dogs, you may really want the flexible ureteroscope to fully get through the urethra for those cases. And then particularly for male dogs or even for male cats, you can get down a lot of the urethra with a small 2.7 flexible ureteroscope. And so again, I think that's where the investment comes in, that you have to have the capacity to have these equipment scopes available. And then outside of that, it's really just your basic lap set. So having your minimally invasive Babcock forceps. If you have stone baskets, I think that can be a big help, and we'll show in Haiku's case that it was a major help for particularly larger stones, as well as for stones that are lodged within the urethra. Making sure you have a urethral catheter, I think that this is pretty obvious, and we'll talk about how it really affects your efficiency in a second. Pressure bag for lavage, as well as the one thing I will mention, especially in some small female dogs or for any of the challenging cat cases, having a weasel wire available to help with the urethral catheterization, just because it really benefits the procedure to be able to do retrograde flushing of the urethra. Patients are positioned similar to kind of anything you're doing on the caudal half of the patient. So your tower at the caudal end, table separated, similar to what Dr. Singh was talking about, just so you have the ability to really move around the patient. And then make sure that you have the urethra draped in, because again, you are going to be flushing that pretty constantly throughout the procedure. So again, starting with percutaneous cystolithotomy, I think that this is what I'm most comfortable with, and so it's what I'll talk about the most. But just really focus on a 1 to 1.5 centimeter incision right at the area of where you suspect that the apex of the bladder will be. And what I mean by that is we know that you're going to have to, or generally you're going to pass a urinary catheter, and often you will take pre-op radiographs. I found that it's very helpful, very beneficial for these cases if you actually evaluate where your incision should be made based off of those preoperative radiographs. It's an incredibly simple step to do, to distend the urinary bladder, find exactly where it lies in relationship to the umbilicus, in relationship to the pelvic brim, in relationship to the prepuce and the penis in a male dog. I think it really can help to target where your incision is and make the procedure much faster if you know exactly where your urinary bladder is going to be once you get into the abdomen. And then truly distend the urinary bladder prior to getting into surgery. I think that this is very important and really helps for your ability to palpate the urinary bladder and make sure that it is in a region of the caudal abdomen that you have easy access to. Then again, you make a very small 1 to 1.5 centimeter incision within the skin, get down to the actual body wall, the linea alba, and that can be a challenge in some of the fatter patients, the patients with an increased body condition. And so some benefits to use, similar to a modified Hassan, just making sure that you have someone on either side of your incision to gradually hold up the tissue. Stay sutures can be very helpful, both in the bladder, which we'll show in just a second, but even for the body wall, it can be very helpful to make sure that you are directly on midline. And then just popping in some small gelpies if you're having a really hard time in some of the more overweight patients. My personal preference, I will do 3 stay sutures into the urinary bladder after we have found it with digital palpation, meaning once you're through the body wall, make sure that you can stick a finger in, feel that you are on the urinary bladder. I always like to run my finger cranially to make sure that it is a truly single organ that you know is consistent with the urinary bladder, meaning that it doesn't continue. There have been not written reports, but stories of people thinking that they're at the urinary bladder and actually going into the colon. So again, I think it's important that you're confident that you're in the urinary bladder, and the digital palpation can really help with that. And then again, get your 3 stay sutures before you even make that stab incision so that you know you have very good control of the urinary bladder. Typically, and I'll show you a picture in a second, but do 1 stay suture at the cranial most aspect and then 2 on either side. There are times that we'll actually even make those stay sutures go all the way up to the skin, meaning essentially tack your urinary bladder to the skin at that level. And then inserting your 5 to 6 millimeter Turnermian endo tip. The cannula that I have in the picture is unfortunately a smooth tip, but I do think that having the Turnermian endo tip that actually has the grooves on it is helpful so that you don't actually have the trocar pulling out inadvertently. And then once you're in the urinary bladder, explore a flush, explore some more. We'll talk about tricks in a second, but one of the first things that can be very beneficial, especially for patients with a lot of very large small stones, is to take the diaphragm off of your trocar and then do retrograde flushing of the urinary bladder. And you'll find that a lot of those very small stones, if you truly are at the region of the urethrus of the urinary bladder, will actually flush out through your port. So without even having to do any kind of advanced techniques, you can get a lot of those stones out early. Just making sure that you have the area packed off well so that no stones are going back into the abdomen. After that, hoovering the bladder, this is something that we'll show in a minute with a video, and then pulling any remaining stones. Typically this is done, if it's available, with a stone basket. If it's not available, you can actually remove the trocar and then just insert your cystoscope and instruments within the tiny cystotomy incision separately without a port to be able to get some of those really big stones out. And then at the end, always explore with a flexible ureteroscope. Again, I think that this is very important. It really helps to ensure that you've removed all stones and made sure that there's nothing that's left behind. So again, just some general setup. And this is actually from the percutaneous cystolithotomy paper that Marilyn Dunn's group published recently. But you can see that they have the patient draped off. They have the urethra already catheterized. You can see that they have the area of the cystotomy packed off with the gauze, and then a threaded cannula that is going into the urinary bladder. You can see they already have the pressure line set up from the cystoscope, so an ingress and an outflow, and then are able to view everything from that single small 1 centimeter incision. It's exactly how I think that most of us are doing our stay sutures. So again, one at the cranialmost aspect and then one on each lateral. And I would really, really emphasize that it's important to make sure that these are really good bites. I think in two cases early on when we were just starting to do these at the University of Minnesota, we did have a handful of sutures, the stay sutures, that actually pulled out of the bladder. And so really making sure that you have a good grip, full thickness on the stay sutures is very valuable. So this is haiku. This is that patient. You can see once we entered with the cystoscope, you can directly see already all of the damage that's gone on just from the trauma of the stones themselves. But the biggest benefit, I think, for doing a minimally invasive approach to bladder stones is the incredible visualization. This is something that instead of blindly trying to fish out stones with a finger in a large cystotomy, you can see exactly where the stones are. You can see exactly how many you still have left to go after. You don't have any hesitation in terms of what you're actually dealing with. The other advantage is that you can actually see pathology, meaning that there are times that if you have a dog with recurrent stones or if you have a dog with severe cystitis and incidentally you identified these bladder stones, you will see polypoid inflammation. You will see actual masses that you can biopsy through, again, this minimally invasive approach. And so it gives you such a much more in-depth appreciation of what's going on within the urinary bladder that you absolutely cannot get from a conventional surgery. And again, here's that case. Here's the patient that has a very large stone. You can see that our Foley is in the urethra at this point, and you can see a little bit of a compression at the region of the trigone. This is a very large stone, and so after we had already done some of the hoovering procedure, after we had already done a ton of flushing, this very large stone was still remaining, and so did go after that with a basket. It's something that, again, we had to take the trocar out of just because this was too large to pass through the trocar, but really different identifies that you can very easily get a basket around these to remove them, and this is a 10-second procedure to get the basket out and to get the stone out this way. So definitely no disadvantage if you're needing to actually basket these during your open procedure. So again, you can see the patient after surgery, no evidence of cystolysis. And I absolutely apologize for this picture. It's a picture of a printed picture, but they did come back as calcium oxalate from University of Minnesota. So definitely a patient that would be otherwise at risk for recurrence. And then just to mention on the lap-assisted cystotomy, there is a video after this that will kind of go over the procedure more in depth. But the big difference, I would say, between a laparoscopic assisted cystotomy and a percutaneous cystolithotomy is that instead of just going in directly for the urinary bladder through your single 1 centimeter incision, you're just going to make 2 1-centimeter incisions. And this can be beneficial if you're not comfortable or if this is one of your first cases. I think there's absolutely no fault in popping in a scope a little bit more cranial within the abdomen to get a good look at everything. It does allow you to make sure that when you are sticking in your Babcocks to try and grab the urinary bladder, you know that you're going to grab the urinary bladder. So the big difference for this is just, again, you have the advantage of popping in that scope within the abdomen and visually actually see that you're confirming and grabbing the urinary bladder, and exactly where within the bladder you're grabbing, I think is another big advantage. Again, the downside is it's just more equipment potentially, meaning that you do have to have your laparoscope, your cystoscope, and your ureteroscope. But again, if those are all things that are already going to be available and there's no difference in cost, there's no difference in your ability to do so, then I think that there is definitely an advantage to considering that. So again, lap-assisted cystotomy, the setup is quite similar to that of a percutaneous cystolithotomy, but the big difference is that you are going to make it another or your first port just on ventral midline, but higher up on the midline. And then you can see the image down below is of the surgeon grabbing the urinary bladder, so that when you actually make your first stab incision, for doing your actual stone removal, you know exactly where you're grabbing the bladder. You know that it is truly the bladder. There's no chance that you're grabbing the colon. And now we'll play the video. So again, this is a laparoscopic assisted cystotomy. I'll back up just a second. So you can see scope is in the abdomen. You can see the bladder. It's already inflamed just from having the presence of the stones. You can see that they made a very small 1 centimeter port placement at the level of, again, the cranialmost aspect of the urinary bladder, not necessarily at the urethra, but at the cranialmost aspect. Grasping it with some form of small graspers or Babcock graspers. And then from there, make your tiny incision into the urinary bladder, and then you're in the process of removing stones. So good visualization of what you see right away. Obviously, the urine is often cloudy. There's often a lot of hematuria already present in these patients. And so this is really where the flushing comes to play. And this is a video of exactly the hoovering technique that I was talking about, in which the benefit is you hook up your suction to one of your ports, and then you can stick your cystoscope into that port. But given that the suction is hooked up where you would normally insufflate, it causes this back pressure. And so you actually can just use that port itself to hoover the bottom of the urinary bladder. So it really, it's like a swimming pool cleaner where it just sucks up any small stones that will fit within the actual width of your port. And it's a great way to really get a lot of those smaller stones out in a fast manner if they didn't come out from your initial flushing. So again, continuing to suction out some more stones. And then you will get to a point where the stones are too big to actually be removed in that manner. And so this is a situation where the instrument is just placed adjacent to your scope within the urinary bladder. So you don't have to extend the bladder incision. You just have to take out the trocar and make sure that the bladder stays distended with your cystoscope, and then you can grab those stones individually. And again, for most patients, this is no different or slower than what you would expect from a conventional cystotomy, where you have to stick your finger in and try and dig all of these out. So great video here. You can see that they're deflating the catheter, and this is where you advance the scope down the urethra. So this is something, again, you don't get this ability to visualize all of this from a conventional surgery. And you can see there was a little stone there that eventually gets removed. Going back, doing a full evaluation of the urethra as it exits the urinary bladder. I think it's important, or kind of one of the things we found is that if you keep the bladder or the catheter in and continue to flush, you can often get some of those very early stones out, and that's what they're just doing. And then just taking a look around, making sure that you confirm that all of the urinary stones have been removed. The one thing that wasn't shown here that I think is also very important, but after you do remove the port, if you had the port in for a while, I think that there's a lot of value to still sticking the scope in and really looking around just the edges, because there have been a couple cases where the stones themselves will get lodged right in between the bladder and where your port is. And so once the trocar is out, I still do a single look around just to make sure that there's nothing left behind. So again, just some quick key tips. Make sure you distend the bladder and really know your position of where you're going for. If you're going to do a percutaneous cystolithotomy, make sure you know the level of the urinary bladder within the caudal abdomen. That's not something that's going to be consistent between all of the patients. And so having that information is going to help with your efficiency. It's going to help with your ability to actually perform this procedure. Flush. I mean, this is something that it's surprising how effective it is just to pop the diaphragm off of your trocar and flush a ton. And then same thing, to truly visualize things, you want to make sure that your urine is clear. So flushing early, doing antegrade and then retrograde for any residual sand, meaning that very similar to avoiding urohydropulsion, if there is a bunch of very small little sandstones that fit within the urethra, you can flush most of those out with your cystoscope. And so really using this flushing as an ability to remove the stones is beneficial. The Hoover technique, I think that was the first thing, or kind of one of the harder things for us to grasp as to how to successfully do that. But once you have the setup working well with your endo tip and your suction, and again, making sure that you kind of get the groove with this, I think it's very successful and very easy to get a lot of very small stones out. And then removing the trocar for any larger stones. I would not hesitate to pop in an actual basket retrieval device to help with some of those really big stones that may not be as easy to grasp. And then just really making sure that you're scoping the entire lower urinary tract. That's the biggest advantage. That's the main reason why you're doing this procedure. And so making sure that you have that capability is going to really serve the patients best. So again, if we have these capabilities, if we have the ability to do this, just because it's been done a different way for the last 20 years, doesn't mean that we can't advance to a better option for these patients. And again, this is something that just no matter what you call it, no matter the specific steps that you use to take it, it's a really great minimally invasive option. It gives you that benefit of truly assessing the entire urethra, truly assessing the entire urinary bladder. It's something that can be used for a lot of non-cat and dog patients as well, meaning that it's been done for goats, it's been done for exotics, rabbits, ferrets. So this is something that, again, especially in some of those smaller patients, you really have the added benefit for those patients. Once you get efficient with this is something that is not the old saying of you can do a cystotomy faster. Once you actually get good at these, once your team gets good at the setup and the teardown, this is something that, again, you can do in a very efficient manner. It's a very good way to introduce minimally invasive surgery for a very common disorder, meaning that if you're not ready to tackle an adrenal just yet based off of the complexity of it, if you're not ready to tackle a gallbladder just yet, everyone is seeing urinary stones, and that's not something that's going to be going away. So this is a very good way to introduce minimally invasive surgery into your practice. And then again, I think we're all hopeful that within the next 5 years, we'll actually have data to suggest that doing a more minimally invasive approach is going to potentially have less stone recurrence, especially for the calcium oxalate dogs. And that's all I have.
Hey Chris, that was a great talk. I must confess, you're going to be mortified when I tell you this. But you know, I'm just maybe I'm kind of lazy, but I just break out the laparoscope, and you know, I used to do the lap-assisted cystotomy. I feel like this is continually evolving technique, as you've mentioned.
Yeah.
Then I started to put the sills port, you know, caudal.
Yeah.
And, you know, I know Dr. Case Brad case at Florida has got a paper coming out with looking at that. But now, and even with all those older cases, I would just take the laparoscope, and this is where you're going to be mortified. And then I would put that into the urinary bladder.
Yeah, then, I've done that before. Yeah.
And then I would put the, you know, smooth 6 millimeter cannula into the bladder and then hoovered it out.
Yeah.
So, you know, I don't know if that's too simple of a procedure, but it gets the job done.
Yeah. We did the same. And I think a lot of it really depends on what equipment of it is available for you and what your comfort level is. Meaning that if you're a surgeon that's never touched a cystoscope before, I don't know if you necessarily need to jump into throwing that in. I think the biggest benefit is really having the ability to have that flexible scope just to confirm things. But I agree. I think that if you can get by with your same lap setup, then
no loss. And I wish we had a flexible scope too, but we don't. And so, you know, that's, you're even more mortified with me.
Yeah.
But, you know, I have that, obviously I have the prep use draped, you know, in our field, and we will sit the scope right in the trigone and aggressively flush. And we've definitely, you know, we had a case recently, we had a, you know, we were flushing, it was like the third or fourth time we were flushing the urethra and a stone came flying through. So we still do that. It'd be great to have that flexible scope, but, you know, as you mentioned, it's not available for everyone. So we still aggressively flush. Totally agree. Having the scope in there makes a world of difference. And yeah, I mean, send them for post-operative grafts still.
Yeah. And the one thing I didn't mention, I know that Runge is also a fan of popping in a wound protector as well. I haven't tried that, but I think that's also a great idea, especially I think for some of those really fat dogs with stones, I think that's probably a big benefit to pop in an Alexis as well.
Yeah. And I wouldn't hesitate, you know, in those, some of those larger dogs, I make the incision a little bit bigger. You know, you could argue, you could do a full open cystotomy through that incision. I mean, that's totally fair.
Yeah.
I'm not going to argue back, but it's nice to have the scope in there. That's for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was a great talk, Chris. Thanks.
Very cool. I don't see any questions. So I guess I'll just say that really appreciate everyone that's been so engaged with these lectures. I will send out a post-event survey. And again, really appreciate any feedback that anyone can provide. This is something that we're looking to really make a consistent thing, meaning that we really want to be able to provide this education, especially for house officers, especially for the variability in training that we know is present across various programs. I think that any kind of program that you think would be a benefit, we're more than happy to throw some things together. So please provide us feedback if you have any suggestions on how to make it better, on how to improve the entire experience. Again, more than happy to continue to make this as good as possible for the residents, the house officers, the interns. And again, look forward to some of the upcoming ones. We're going to have a thoracoscopy course. We're going to have a really great boards prep sometime late summer or next fall. And there are already people preparing for that. So really want to make sure that this is good for our early members within VES.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for all your time last few nights. And thanks, Chris, for your time as well. And, you know, as Chris mentioned, definitely any feedback would be appreciated for us. We want to help you. And, you know, don't hesitate to reach out if there's anything that you can suggest for us.
Awesome. And these are recorded, so I will post them online for future viewing as well. Awesome. We'll see you guys later.
Thanks. Stay well, everyone.
Yeah.